So, a very, very warm welcome to you, and thanks for joining us today. It's great to see you here in the room. I know we've got a beautiful spring day outside. We're very keen to continue with doing both in-person and online events, really for access reasons and to ensure that we can reach a broad range of audiences. So it's great to have you here with us today. My name is Eleanor Morgan, and I'm Artistic Director at MIMA, Middlesbrough Institute of Modern Art, which is part of Teesside University and based in Middlesbrough, as you might expect, in the Tees Valley. And in terms of a brief visual description, I am a white woman with sort of auburn grey curly hair, and I'm in a green room with some books behind me, and I'm wearing a beige top today. And we're here, as you know, to hear from the really wonderful artist Annie O'Donnell and to celebrate her latest commissions with MIMA. So I'll pass to Annie shortly, but I just wanted to set the scene a little bit before we begin. In terms of housekeeping, we are aiming to run till about 3 o'clock. Annie will be talking for the majority of the hour, but we'll have some time for questions and discussion after. So please keep your thoughts and questions until I come back on screen, and then we'll open up for those. You can either type them in the chat, or if you prefer to come on camera or just microphone, it would be great to hear from you. So I'll bring you in at that right time. We're recording the talk, as you've probably noticed, and we'll be keeping that for our archive, but also we'll share the portion of Annie's talk publicly, so not the Q&A section. Okay, so with that done, here we are, more people joining. It's my pleasure to introduce Annie O'Donnell, who is an artist working in the Tees Valley, who's very, stunning and thought-provoking large-scale commissions form a really integral part of the current exhibition at MIMA, which is titled Chemical City. And I imagine quite a few of you have seen the show, but if not, it's actually just been extended until the end of May. So I hope you get a chance to experience the work in person if you're able. Of course, we're going to have a kind of behind the scenes look with Annie today, and she'll bring to life the works in the space. So Annie's been working with MIMA since MIMA was initiated, I think. But for this exhibition, we've been working together for quite a few years now, because it's such a significant body of work that Annie's developed. And of course, during the process of planning for the exhibition, we encountered the global pandemic. So there's been a lot of many years actually of conversation to this point. And it's been a real joy to work with Annie in the run up to the exhibition, both through this collaboration and the commissions, but also before those even began. So as well as Annie's work in Chemical City, you'll also experience work by Anya McCausland and Katerina Jadar. And underpinning the exhibition is a really significant body of research by Esther Leslie, who's written 3 texts that we'll be sharing shortly and was really involved in thinking the kind of concepts and theories of the exhibition through with me. Lynn Hugill and students from the MIMA School of Art and Design have also been really important in shaping one section of the exhibition. And I'm hoping that many of you are familiar with the show, but just in brief, really, like the wider programme at MIMA, it is rooted in the Tees Valley and connected with global questions, concerns. It's an exhibition that looks at the social, environmental, economic impacts and legacies of the chemicals industry, and particularly the production of synthetics in the Tees Valley. And as somebody who's moved to the area, this has felt like an incredibly important set of stories and histories to explore, and one that perhaps is less known locally, but also nationally and internationally, than some of our stories around the steel industry, for example. I think that's partly because it's so complex and so contested and so distributed. So the things that were made in the Tees Valley were often part of a much bigger process of production. They're perhaps less concrete and tangible. But also I think because some of the impact of what happened was incredibly toxic and harmful. And so there's a complicated social history to unpick here. And since beginning to think about this history and the area's relationship really to industry and production, conversations with Annie have really informed and shaped my thinking around the certainly the social life and the kind of built and physical environment of the chemical works in the Tees Valley. So when I started to think more concretely about working on an exhibition around this, it seemed essential that Annie was part of the project. And actually, at one point in a group conversation, I think Annie said, you know, that there would have been a riot if she hadn't been, from her point of view. There also would from our point of view. So it's been a real pleasure. And as we'll hear from Annie, her work is really, it connects through the use of materials and stories and imagery from the area with her family's relationship to this place, but also much wider societal relationships to place and to memory and to myth making. I think you'll also get a sense from the way that Annie talks about her work of her former career profession in dance and the relationship between the work that she makes now and different forms of embodied knowledge and experience. And Annie's work is additive. And I think of it really as assemblage or collage. You know, she often works with found materials, found imagery, and even on the scale of the pieces in MIMA, it has a sense of being something that's collage-like or flottage. So for this exhibition, we invited, encouraged, but also perhaps challenged Annie to scale up some of the things that she's been doing in this area and to work on two very large scale commissions, which build on the brilliant sculpture that she's been making over time, but also bring in elements of collage and working on paper and some of the more performative aspects of Annie's work. It's been a real pleasure to work with her on this, and there have been many people involved in the process. And we really wanted to just give a moment to, I suppose, peer behind the scenes and get inside some of the thinking of the work. So I'll pass now to Annie, who's going to bring to life some of the whys and the hows of the work, and then we'll come back for a bit of a Q&A. So Annie, I'll hand over to you. We'll just give you a moment to share your screen, and look forward to hearing from you. Thank you.
Yeah, I just wanted to thank Eleanor for that really great introduction. I'm not entirely certain there's anything left for me to say after that. She's been really comprehensive. Perhaps I'll start with just a description of myself. I'm a white woman in my early 60s with long white hair. I'm wearing big pink glasses and a pink shirt. And I'm sitting in the corner of my kitchen. I just wanted to thank Eleanor and all the team at MIMA for allowing me to be part of the exhibition. It's been absolutely fabulous. And also to thank everybody for giving up time, especially those who are experiencing a sunny Saturday afternoon. I really do appreciate it. As Eleanor was saying, I've really been encouraged to expand my practice through its ambition and through its physical scale, through working at MIMA. And it's been great to have a longer period of time to really think things through as well. The Chemical City theme is central to my practice. I'm very interested in people's initial experiences of place, probably when they're children, and how this sort of forms how they see both that place and other places. So essentially, how people make places and how places make people. In the sense of the Chemical City exhibition, I'm particularly interested in the sense of a company, in this case ICI, being a city within itself, and its effect on whole families rather than on just, in a lot of industries, it's essentially a male working population that affects, is affected by the company, whereas in Billingham especially, I would say, which is a company town, or was a company town, whole families were affected. But perhaps I'll talk about that a little bit more as I sort of share some images with you. I've decided to use images from the exhibition itself. The two large sculptural installations that Eleanor mentioned, and also some smaller sculptures, which were the starting points in collage form, although I think of them as being sort of assemblages, sculptural assemblages, really. So let me just see if I can share the slideshow with you now.
Looking good.
That's great. So the three pieces that I'm going to sort of talk through and use to talk you through the exhibition are Future Booster, which is a wall painting with sculptural attachments, essentially, and fabric drapes. All Things Being Equal, which is a large structure in the gallery that leads on from that space, which is a structure in itself, and it also acts as a sort of holder for wearable sculptures. And then Plans for Plants, which, as I say, are the sort of collages slash assemblages, which are in conversation with family photographs, essentially. So that'll sort of give us a structure for what I'm going to talk about today. So here we go. First slide. This is an installation image by Rachel Deakin, and it is showing one corner of the first gallery in Chemical City. The smaller door on the left-hand side is where you enter from the atrium space. So you enter from a large space into a small space, and then you go into this large cube, which is, I think it's about something like 8.5 meters by 8.5 meters, and it's a little bit taller than that, but essentially it is a cube space. And Future Booster is the work on the right-hand side of this image. It's green and yellow and blue and orange and hot pink. And all of those are colours that I would think of as being in my ICI palette. I'm very drawn to high colour and to artificial colour. You would also see these colours in a garden, but they would generally be sort of hybrid plants rather than sort of plants in their natural form, I would say, which again is something I'll sort of touch on later too. So this space was going to be the sort of utopian space, if you like, the forward thinking that ICI wanted to project when it first started in the late 1920s in this area, but also sort of going through, probably right through until about the 70s, I would say. Light levels are quite low because there's a lot of archival pieces in the space, lots of things on paper, ICI magazines and Perspex samples and things like that. As you can see, there's also some clothing and there's an ICI flag. I know the space is very well too. As Eleanor suggested, I've sort of had connections with MIMA for quite a long time. And so I knew it was quite a while since the full height of the space had been used. And I was very keen to give a sense of the monumentality of MIMA. Well, of course, MIMA is monumental, but of ICI, should I say, and how it makes you feel when you feel you're being overlooked by something really large. So in this space, you would be looking down at archival material, but then also up at the wall piece. And, you know, then you get a sense of that sort of transgressive body sense, you know, where you feel very large and then you feel very small. And most of my work has some sort of implicit sense of the body, as Eleanor was saying, because of my previous career as a dancer. Okay, on to the next image. This is the same space, but showing the sort of wall that faces you as you come in. And there is a really great film from the Eyesight Archives, which is from the Northeast Film Archive. And there are some great images here. And a lot of it relates directly to my family. You know, there'll be pictures of people playing hockey for Synthonia, which was ICI's sort of sports section, you know, and quite a few of my family members, like my dad and uncle, played hockey. And then it's just stuff about the labs and things like that, where they worked essentially, and the plastics department. I wanted the wall piece to have a sense of movement, although it is a static piece, that there was a sense of energy running through other things that were happening in the exhibition, things like the film, things like the vitrines, and then these sort of lines come up and over the doorway. I should say this doorway is about 3.5 meters high, so it is really quite quite substantial. And again, that is an image by Rachel Deakin. MIMA offered me a fantastic opportunity to work in collaboration with a fabricator, David Stupple, of Cowsike Workshop. And that has been an absolutely fabulous experience. I produced, I think, about four choices, really, for us to look at for the wall piece. And then David rendered them digitally so we could have a better idea of how they might look in the space. So this is the piece that we actually chose. Other alternatives, the yellow was going right up to the top of the ceiling, or it was sweeping in lines around the bottom. But this is the one I think everybody sort of was, we were drawn to more. The sort of pink rods that are coming out of the wall, I'd asked David if he would be able to fabricate meter long metal rods with a ball on the end, and that they were to support fabric that was going to be hung right from the top of the space, which is 9 meters odd, something like that. The rendering on the right hand side gives an example of how David was able to give really accurate measurements, so I could make the, what I was calling fins, but I think we eventually decided to call them banners, that would hang in between these rods. And that worked out really, really well. And that's the first chance I've had to work with a fabricator like that. My working methods have been described as farmer's methods, where you just sort of take a nail and hammer it into something to attach it to something. I don't usually have beautifully fabricated elements. So that's been really brilliant to work with David. These are some other shots to give you a little bit of a better idea of how Future Booster looked. The left hand side image is from the actual installation, and that's Rory, one of the technical team on the Genie lift, who is sort of making final adjustments to the rods and the mesh. Again, it was absolutely brilliant to have a team who could just sort of follow drawings and you know, that you could talk things through with, and then they would make things happen. And the image on the right hand side is a sort of clearer shot. The structure that's sort of on the wall isn't an actual structure within ICI, but it is definitely sort of influenced by large industrial structures. And again, I'll show you some images as we go through. That'll give you a better idea of where those ideas came from. This is sort of just closer images of the rods, which at one point I was calling shillelaghs or knob carries. They did really look like some sort of lethal weapon. And the image on the right is just an example of how we sort of placed the rods. It was very important that they were in very specific places, because the drapes were of a specific length by this point. And I just love the way it sort of plays into the corner. Yeah, this is a closer look at what I'm actually hanging here. It's debris mesh that is used on buildings, mainly when people are using scaffolding to make alterations or to build things, just to stop small debris falling through onto people and things underneath. It's a knitted fabric, and so it has a really wide stretch across it, but not much stretch sort of lengthways. And I used a 2 meter wide debris mesh, which I then folded in half. And I loved this this particular blue colour, which I see is a particularly ICI colour. When it arrived, it was actually edged in orange, which I didn't know about, but I was absolutely delighted by. And so I used that as a leading edge on the banners. It looks in the space as if it's pink because the rods are pink, but it is definitely orange. And on the right-hand side is an image of what the piece looks like as you exit from the fourth gallery, which is the gallery where Katerina Gidard's work is. And if you're coming back into the first gallery, the cube space, it started to give me a feeling of sort of tomb entrances, some ancient structure. But that didn't really happen until I actually felt it through my body in the space. This strange looking thing is from the Billingham Post, which was ICI's magazine for the community of Billingham. And it was a small article on a trade fair that they were attending in the 1950s in Iraq. And I was just really drawn to this image, to these sort of repeated flagpoles, to the ICI roundel of the logo, the sort of tripod shape that was held on, the mural at the bottom of the image. It just seemed like a very typically ICI image. And I decided to try and track down designers who might have made these exhibition stands for ICI across the world. So this was a really important trigger, really, very small image. This is the designer who I found and was really drawn to. His name was Beverly Pick. I did initially think it was a woman and got a bit excited about that, but it wasn't. But these are two sort of typical images of Pick's work. On the left-hand side, we have a trade fair stand for a fabric company. And as you can see, he's made a sort of strange tower with the sort of Sputnik effect rods that I've used, and these sort of fins that run down and then spread out. And then the things underneath as well that look like sort of, I don't know, upturned umbrellas or things that you would see in the ICI site. And there's a mural there as well. And then on the right hand side, there is an example of a Pick sketch presentation. And a lot of these things remind me of the plant itself. You don't often get a clear view through to something. You're often looking at a large structure with something else in front of it. And then it's hard to tell where one thing starts and finishes and another thing starts. And these are both from the 1950s. He was a designer who did trade fairs, but also did sort of window displays and the Christmas lights at Regent Street in London and things like that. Very under-researched, and I was really grateful to come across his work and be able to sort of highlight it. These are the sort of places where I found his work. On the left-hand side, on holiday in the Lake District, we came across a stash of these display design and presentation magazines from the late 40s, early 50s. And Beverly Pick was a regular contributor to that magazine. And there's a piece in that magazine about before the Festival of Britain and sort of post Second World War, there was the first exhibition, trade exhibition, was called Britain Can Make It. And it was really important from a sort of industry and design relationship point, you know, from that point of view. So I love this. It there was the headquarters of the agricultural division of ICI was in Billingham. And to give you an idea, it was sort of like a Le Corbusier type office building, but in a provincial northern town. And behind that is this fantastic car park. When ICI was still operating, this was beautifully manicured. I actually climbed through a hole in a fence, which I suppose was technically trespassing, to take these photographs. I know they're not particularly brilliant photographs, but yeah, it, which isn't an activity I normally do, and I wouldn't suggest it's what anybody else does really. And I did almost fall down and open manhole cover at one point because I backed up to take photographs. So I would definitely not suggest that it's the way forward. But you can see that it's had a definite influence on the wall painting. This is the structure from the other side. And I'm showing you this because of the sort of covered walkway that runs along the car park. All the sort of lesser beings, if you like, would have parked their cars out in the open. And then the sort of more important people, in inverted commas, would have parked within the structure itself. And then, you know, people had the choice to sort of walk undercover to enter the building. But I use this as a sort of trigger for the piece that I'll go on to talk about later in the second gallery. Other strange triggers which might be, some would be surprising perhaps. On the left-hand side is a piping gantry through ICI. And this is a sort of bridge that goes across the road. You can see the sort of structure of it on the right-hand side. And it's normally open, and there would be pipes of different colours, orange, yellow, purple, those sort of colours, all carrying different things from one side of the road to the other. And there are quite a few of these bridges. And as a sort of creative child in living on the edge of a chemical plant, I always saw them as sort of proscenium arches of theatres, and sort of entering one scene from the former scene, that sort of thing. And then on the right-hand side, I love this oil painting. It's by Piero della Francesca, and it's really very small. I think it's only something like 60 centimetres by 80 centimetres, and it's essentially a devotional object, and it's got a lot of stories attached to it, who the characters are, what's actually going on, what the symbolism is behind the structures and the people. And I'm really drawn to that because my use of materials is because of the physicality of the material, but it's also because I see them as metaphors for other things. So, you know, the mesh could be seen as something that is not solid and therefore could be a little bit elusive. It's also something where you can see other things through it. That's a sort of example of how I see materials. And here, there are so many things. I mean, I just love the sense of perspective. I mean, this would actually have been probably placed on either an altar or a fairly high table. And then, you know, you would have viewed it kneeling down, essentially. So you would view it from beneath. And if you do that, the perspective is even stronger, really. But I also love the fact that these people are very definite characters. They're not just sort of the same person in different clothes, essentially. And, you know, the use of colour is, you know, really draws me. And, you know, just simple things like the soft leather boots or the bare feet or the emperor type figure at the back wearing the strange hat. And there's a guy with a turban and just the little staircase at the back. Just these sort of details that are almost like abstract things, the drapery of the costumes and things like that. All of this had influence. And I've loved this since I first saw it, and it stayed with me sort of right through my practice. Right, this is sort of starting to move on until the next space. This is probably my favourite installation shot by Rachel Deakin, and it's looking through to Gallery 2. And I love the sort of repeated rectangles in that sort of vertical alignment and then in the horizontal alignment. And the photograph of the tiny person inside one of the ICI silos just gives you an idea of how monumental ICI is. You know, my work shrinks into insignificance in comparison with the sizes of the structures. And the small helmet on the right-hand side links to work, the wearable sculptures, and to thoughts of the mine that ran underneath the town where my grandfather worked. Right, these are again two of the renderings for the exhibition. On the left-hand side, we have a small initial rendering that I sat with my husband and worked through. And I wanted ideas of a sort of space that you would wander through, but there were alternative ways of moving through the space, essentially. And then David Stupple, we worked around that, and we thought if we wanted it to be a certain height, what materials we were going to have to use for it to be that height, and scaffolding became the obvious choice. And so the right hand side is actually a rendering of the finished piece. On the left hand side here, we've got one of the renderings that showed how the structure would align to things like doorways. And also to Anya's work, which is on the right hand side, to give enough space for that to be seen and for this work to be seen properly, and for it also to speak to architectural elements within the gallery. The right hand side is another one of Rachel's images, which shows the wearable sculptures that have been hung at this point. Danny, one of the technical crew, was really helpful in this whole installation of this piece. And it had probably more relation to how I would normally install, that I've got a lot of elements and then there's a sort of performative, improvisational way of making the work. So, yeah, I had an idea of how it was going to look, but it was... I just find it quite refreshing to be able to not be entirely sure of everything. And that's what this piece enabled. And these are just two more shots, really, to give you an idea of how the piece looks in the space. The two large openings in the piece mirror the dimensions of the light boxes. So they are 4.5 meters by 1.5 meters. And I wanted a sort of... a structure that stood as a sculpture in itself, but it was also a carrier for other things. But it also had a feeling for perhaps something ancient or something old that had been abandoned. This room was not exactly dystopian, but it had elements of how things would be, you know, if you used a landscape and used a set of people in order to produce something. When that was over, you know, what would things look like, essentially? This space also had archival things relating to my family, essentially. Going on to the sort of wearable sculptures, on the right-hand side are two of my Ma's friends. I think this is probably the very late 1940s. And then on the left-hand side, there is a gentleman who I don't know who that is, but it's also my dad. And I love these coats. They are official garments, so you have to sort of put them on and become a company person. But unlike the images on the films, that are like official films where everybody's lab coats are absolutely pristine and everybody looks the same, essentially. These are the sort of images that we had at home. And I don't know if you can sort of see, you know, people are wearing brooches, they're wearing necklaces, they've got their own belts on, they've got spectacles in their pockets, their lab coats look a bit tatty, they're got stuff on them. I don't know what that is. And they have pocketbooks where they've obviously made notes about things that are happening in the lab. And I'm quite drawn to that. These were also influences for the mainly for the lab coat and for the boiler suit in that space. Langer lines, which are skin tension lines on the body, we all have. I was quite interested in, you know, if people come to a place from somewhere else, what can they keep about their identity and what do they have to give up in order to fit in? You know, ideas of stripping the skin back or stripping the self back. And then just little sketches that I started to make about how I could put the Langer lines onto the clothing. And it all went a bit Stepanova at this point, the female Russian constructivist artist who made a whole load of designs for industrial clothing and sports clothing that were non-gender specific. And this is sort of a little bit more detail about that sort of idea. And so the lab coat in the image on the right is painted, but it also has lots of red biro involved in its Langer lines. And then the biros are actually in the top pocket together with a sort of ceremonial object, which is a piece of cotoneaster. There's a lot of ivy, which was dyed with silk dye. I quite like putting two things together that aren't supposed to be together, which again is metaphorical. Or I like tying things together, how things are attached. I'm sometimes more interested in attachments than I am to the actual objects. And again, these are sort of family photographs of fancy dress parties, drinking games, all sorts of things like that. My mother with her friends in various social situations. And as Eleanor was saying, that's of real interest to me. You know, I like to see how companies can affect people right across the board. You know, what people have to do to survive, essentially. So here we've got bonnets, we've got bibs, we've got aprons, we've got scarves, we've got big shoulder pads, all that sort of thing. And all of this affected the wearable sculptures that I made. It's a close-up of the lab coat and also some wearable sculptures. They're made of a polyester material, but they're also padded. So they can be worn in different ways. There's a sort of hat that makes you look like a fox on the right hand side towards the bottom. And then there are other pieces that you're not entirely certain what they're supposed to be for. They've got tape on them and you can attach them to different parts of your body. That's, I think, really, that's more like how I would usually work insofar as it's a sculpture and it's not for a specific body part. But then the lab coat and the boiler suit were more explicit. These are examples of family ceremonial objects. I probably shouldn't go into this in too much detail. There's a lot of things that I could have sort of shared here, but essentially we have these sort of haystack creatures who are known as Whittlesea bears, and the much older frontal headdress, which is obviously antlers, which would have been worn on a sort of soft leather balaclava, essentially. And I'm just interested in where people's families came from before they hit Billingham, essentially, and their more rural roots. And a lot of us have really close links to that sort of landscape, essentially. And so to come through these various forms of industry in order to help your family, it must have been exciting and yet a bit of a shock to the system at the same time. And these, again, are just sort of close-ups of materials. The discs, the perspex discs within the sort of large wearable sculpture that looks like a bag or double-sided pockets or something like that were from a previous work called Narcissus, which had a lot of wearable sculptures for emergencies of various types. This was all pre-pandemic, the emergency wearables, but they did come into my mind during the pandemic as if there was something in the air that I must have sort of picked up on. And the piece on the right hand side obviously bears some resemblance to the Whittlesea bears, and it's a sort of cloak, but it could also be a skirt, and it just sort of It's Hessian and muslin natural materials, which are dyed. I'm quite interested in the idea of dye rather than paint because it permeates further into the fabric and it's as if your new identity is soaking further into you. Yeah, let's move on. Okay, so these are, this is the first one of the plans for plants, which ICI is always referred to locally as a plant. You never, well, I haven't heard of it referred to as a factory as such. And so you've got that play on words, the whole idea of gardens and industry. So I made a series of about, I think there were about 26 of these collages, which were sketches initially, four ideas, but then became more like finished works in themselves. And I chose three of them and then put them in conversation with family photographs that we had. So they're a bit like, I had quite clear ideas of how I wanted them framed and mounted. So one side is a little bit like an old style family photograph album, and the right hand side is probably more like, yes, I was just going to say that all of the images, all of the photographs in that particular image relate to an Aldous Huxley essay. He wrote a series of essays that eventually led to the Brave New World novel. And he wrote them, he visited a lot of industrial places up and down the country, but he visited Billingham. And if you read Brave New World, a lot of the descriptions of the industrial plant are of Billingham. But he does say in one of the essays that nobody in the area grew any food. And I just found it really interesting that I had these tiny photographs, family photographs of our family at the time when he was visiting. And in the distance, you can actually see our family's vegetable garden. And I just found it really sort of interesting that he'd have been shown round what the ICI officials wanted him to see, I guess, and fed a certain narrative. And yet all this other more layered stuff was happening. And so the collages are sort of in conversation with that. And they're also a bit of a tribute to the family, you know, who worked in various ways. You know, my grandfather worked underground in the anhydrite mine. Both my parents worked in the plastics division. My mum doing what she termed as a man's job during the Second World War. And then all the women had to stand aside and take more sort of clerical roles when the guys came back. So I don't really see ICI as just sort of one narrative. I've also got aunts and uncles and cousins too that were involved. And you could ask anybody really in the area if they know anybody that used to work in ICI or works in one of the plants that are now owned by different companies. And I guess everybody would know that. And yet, as you were saying in your introduction, it's not such a narrative that's spoken about in art terms, really. It is definitely more fragmented, as you were saying. But it makes it really interesting as well, these sort of overlapping stories. And they sort of resemble those forms and colors in the plant itself. You know, it's never just one thing, it's always lots of things. It's a shame. I did actually have a slide where I was sort of referencing the texts that I'd looked at just for the PowerPoint essentially, but hopefully if this is recorded, maybe, I don't know if that would be possible for that to be shared, maybe. It would be. I mean, my research is fairly wide, but it was just a few things that I'd sort of talked about during this PowerPoint that people might think, oh, that was quite interesting. I'll take a look.
Great. Okay. Well, maybe we could also put them back out through email because people have signed up for this. So
okay.
Thank you so much, Annie. And thanks for persevering and sticking with it and for giving us such an insight into, as you say, the really layered things that you're doing through the work. And I think you gave a real sense there of relationships to the materials themselves, their properties, their histories, their associations, but also the politics of labour and that whole fascinating topic that we've talked a lot about the kind of push and pull between what could be called natural and what could be called human made, you know, this exchange of of properties and histories, and of course the some of the negative impacts of that, but there is this real reciprocal relationship in the area. So I think your use of things like ivy alongside the netting and the, you know, really plasticky plastics has been such a fascinating embodiment of some of the nature of this region, really. So thank you very much. I'm going to welcome any questions, if there are some. Okay, there's a nice comment from Claire Harrison in the chat saying you didn't miss a step, which is true. One thing, whilst people just gather their thoughts if they wanted to ask anything, that I thought it would be interesting to hear about is just, obviously, the way that this show works is very different from either a solo exhibition or a straightforward group exhibition of, you know, just artworks. It incorporates many different archival materials, artifacts, but also contemporary products and design alongside the three artist commissions. So what was it like to work in that way and with those materials in mind? Because you really gave a sense of the relationship between your work and the wider exhibition in your talk. How did that differ, or how did that influence the way that you worked for this?
Yeah, I mean, it was fascinating. I mean, I make solo shows, obviously, but I also collaborate with other artists where our work is in conversation with each other. I do that on a regular basis, but this was different from that, essentially. But because of the sort of my confidence in the whole sort of curatorial events that were happening, I felt quite happy about that, and it sort of stretched me. The first gallery, I would say, was probably easier on some levels, because I have actually shown work alongside my own archival material before, and I had started to work out ideas of miniature, and then it would be probably as tall as I could reach on the top of a ladder, that sort of scale, certainly not the scale we're talking about now. One of the things that I had to contend with in that space was I had originally seen the work on the opposite wall. And so the flow of the exhibition was going to be counterclockwise, anti-clockwise. And I had seen it as sort of an entrance into the exhibition. In the end, it sort of became, I didn't see it as an entrance on the other wall, really. It was just sort of more of a sort of ta-da moment. And then in the other space, working together with Anya's piece, which was a 13 meter painting. That was fascinating because Anya's color palette is very different from mine. You know, mine is quite an industrial palette, whereas Anya's is sort of the what actually happens at the end of the industrial process, but it looks more like a natural tone color. And so I would probably never have set the red structure against that ochre color. And yet when I saw it, it was absolutely fantastic and I loved it. And it has a sort of glow as you stand in the first gallery. And then I would also say, looking through to the other side, looking through to Katarina's work, through the future booster, you can sometimes see in the movement of the hands on the screen, on the film in her piece, colours that crop up that are actually in my piece too. And so there's movement of the colour there as well. And that was really fantastic. I think some of the wearable sculptures sort of connected with the third gallery at the back, where that has all the brilliant new products that you were talking about, and alternatives to plastics. So they look similar, but they're made in a very different way. And that was, all of this is sort of looking back and looking forward. I mean, those three figures at the front of the Piero della Francesca painting are sometimes thought to represent past, present, and future. They're also said to represent specific people. But I think the exhibition definitely has that sort of feeling. It's not literally looking back in time all the time. It's also feeling the current moment and, you know, a more hopeful approach to how we make things going forward, really. And that's been fabulous to be part of that.
Thank you, Annie. There's a question here about activating the wearable sculptures at any point. So are there plans to have these worn?
Oh, God. I mean, that was totally the plan from the start. I mean, when we first started talking pre-pandemic, the wearables were going to be put on as you entered the gallery, and then people could wear them as they walked around and, you know, see where, how they felt if they were wearing these things. Then, of course, as you said, the small question of the pandemic arose. And at one point, we didn't know how it was transferred, really. You know, we thought it was airborne, but we were also a little bit edgy about touching things that somebody else had touched. And then it became a very different sort of ball game. But I was determined to still go through with the idea of things that could be worn. And I think it sort of mirrors how my work is often seen anyway. Often when people enter a space where I have works in conversation with each other, it's as if somebody has been doing something in that space but has just left the room. Or it could be ready for somebody to come in to do something. And I mean, I would love, especially now the exhibition is on until the end of May, I would love people to come into the space. I mean, I obviously we'd need to talk about this. I don't know whether they can touch things yet, but if they wanted to bring their own stuff in and work in the space, you know, I would absolutely love it, in, especially in the probably in the second gallery where there is, it's a little bit like a structure for some sort of activity to happen, you know, and even if people wanted to come in and sketch even, or, you know, or bring their own wearable things in or film, you know, anything like that, I think would be absolutely brilliant. Yeah, definitely. Yes.
That's such a lovely invitation. Thank you. Yeah, that structure definitely gives a sense of a kind of civic centre or a public architecture, doesn't it? I wonder if there are any other questions coming through. If you'd like to unmute and speak, then that's great. If you wanted to type, also fine. I can see one. Possibly question or comment from Christopher Kent coming. So we'll just hold on for that. And oh, looks like it might have stopped. Okay. If anybody would like to chip in, please feel free. Otherwise, I think we will wrap up there, Annie, with many thanks for sharing your work in such depth and taking us through the journey of all of those kind of family and very intimate memories and associations, and how those for you map onto, you know, very well-known or more kind of nationally recognised moments like Festival of Britain Design and all of the wonderful materials and fabrics that came out of this area, alongside the impact, of course, that we're living with today in terms of the use of plastics. Yes. Okay. We're getting some nice comments, but no questions. So we'll wrap up there, Annie, and I'll just give a huge thank you to giving that behind the scenes look at your work.
Thank you. I'm sorry for blowing the system several times.
I think it was just too exciting. The visual
chemical image reaction.
Too much. Yeah, no, amazing archival images and great shots of your work in situ. So I do hope people have a moment to visit the exhibition, and yeah, please do come and see us. Thank you so much, Annie.
Thank you.
It's been a real pleasure to work together.